our co-founders is here. His name is Scott Barta. He's over at our table. We do Sasquatch research mainly in Colorado, but I do Wyoming, and I also go to Utah, and obviously Harriet's here in Nebraska. I want to talk about that a little bit before we get started here. A lot of people ask me, are there really Sasquatches in Nebraska? I have a researcher. His name is David Otke, and he's been with me for quite a while. He used to be a BFRO member, now he's a SIR member. And he's been Sasquatching in the panhandle of Nebraska for 20 years. So the answer to that is yes. Yes. The BFRO is also active here. A lot of people don't know this. How many people know that you can hunt mountain lions in Nebraska? There's actually a season for it. So where do you think they're coming from? They're coming from Colorado and Wyoming. They're following the drainages up. Everything's following the drainages up. I grew up in central Kansas as a boy, and I never saw a mountain lion in central Kansas until a couple of years ago. My uncle has one on his property. The DOW there won't accept them, so they don't exist in Kansas, but they exist in Nebraska. But there's one on my uncle's land. There's also two elk that we see once in a while, two cow elk. So everything's moving this direction. They used to be plains animals, and now they are again. So nobody should be surprised by that. So do I think there's Sasquatches in Nebraska? Yes. Do I think there's a lot of Sasquatches in Nebraska? No. Some pretty well-known places that I've never been to, but they say there are Sasquatches is up on the reservations, the Winnebago and the Omaha reservations. I've never been there to confirm or deny that. I'd like to someday. My grandmother was born in Winnebago, Nebraska in 1924. And she just passed away this year, by the way. And she was married, so I have ties around here. A lot of people don't know that. I didn't really understand that until this last year. My great-grandmother was married in Red Cloud. And when I was a kid, I used to come up from Salina and I used to go to our family reunions at the windmill in Smith Center. So I never put two and two together, but I'm actually of this place somewhat. So it's funny how things come full circle. So I am that guy. So I'm gonna get started. And I also wanna take the time to thank Harriet. Harriet puts in a lot of time and work and does a lot of research work for us here in Nebraska. And I thank the world of Harriet. She's a great lady. Okay, I'm hoping this plays. I don't know how to make this play. Okay. This is out of Trinidad.
When I was on this hunt, I saw a ton of bears, but I kept constantly getting kind of a freaky feeling, and I didn't know whether it was a bear watching me or what was going on. We had a bunch of stealth cams out so we could track and see what kind of bears were in the area. When we went and checked one of the stealth cams that I had set up to watch a trail, we lucked out and caught something that triggered the stealth cam 15 feet away from our target area. It scared me when I saw it. I'm not going to say what it is. You make your own decision. Take a look at this. We got 9 frames of something I can't describe.
Does everybody know who that is? That's Fred Eichler of Easton Bow. He's a professional bow hunter. He was hunting for bears down in Trinidad, Colorado a few years, actually more than a few years. This video's actually been out there a while, but not very many people know about it. He's a professional bow hunter hunting bears. So he's an expert in tracking. He's an expert in bear identification. He's an expert in bear footprints. And he's telling you, that isn't a bear. He's telling you point blank, I got something in my trail cam, it's not a bear.
You know, I'm an investigator in my job. The quality of the witness makes all the difference in the world. You can't get a better witness than Fred Eichler. That's what he does for a living, is finds bears. And he was down in Trinidad doing that. Now, you can kind of make out the body. It's not the first. It's not the best. But I wanted people to see that. There's all kinds of evidence out there that people are getting and finding. And it's also a good example of what you generally get on a trail cam. It's like they sense them. And if you notice, it's a nine-shot burst is what he's setting his trail cams on. And in that nine-shot burst, that Sasquatch, I know for a fact, he's sensing that thing going off and he's getting out of the picture pretty fast. So that's why it's such a brief encounter, because that's what we get a lot. We'll get quick shots, we'll get flashes, we'll get things like that. It's almost like they know they're there, they can sense they're there. We actually think they watch us put them up as well. So stealth cams aren't the best things to use to get a picture of a Sasquatch. So I wanted you to see another perspective, somebody else's evidence. And I love that video because you can kind of, if you go on the YouTube and look at it, and it's only got 50,000 hits, which should have millions, I think, because you can see the body shape of the Sasquatch in this video. If you stop it, you got half of his body. See his head, his whole body. The other thing that's interesting, Fred doesn't say much, but he tells you that it's 15 feet away from the camera. So Fred, he doesn't say whether there was footprints or there was anything like that. Usually a bear, Trinidad's a pretty dry place. Usually a bear will leave footprints all over the place. Sasquatches don't. He didn't say there were footprints all over the place, did he? He didn't present that evidence either, probably because there wasn't any. They leave scuffs and things like that. Their feet are so big and flat. I'm sure he looked at that as well. He just didn't say anything about it because there wasn't anything to say. So I thought that was a good piece of evidence to show you. I want to show you some other people's stuff. So I want to talk about this. How many people saw this in the news recently? I think this is a big piece of news. People are a lot of people are really down and negative on Bigfoot. I'm not. Missing North Carolina in Wood City, survived thanks to a friend. He hung out with a bear for 2 days. So what's wrong with this story? Isn't it winter in North Carolina? Aren't bears hibernating? If they were here, wouldn't they be hibernating? So bears aren't even in the picture. I've talked to some of my research friends from that area. Bears aren't even in the picture. So either the three-year-old's telling a tall tale. What's also interesting about this story is the FBI got involved from day one. I live in Denver, and we get an Amber Alert every week. The FBI isn't getting involved. Every Amber Alert. Why was this one so different than the rest? What's interesting is Craven County is a very remote part of North Carolina down by the coast, and there's a national park right next to it, or right in it. And it's very rugged and very tough to get around. And I just wonder if the FBI kind of maybe knew, they wanted to be proactive in case, you know, I don't know. It's just strange that they were involved. A lot of people say he might have been abducted by somebody. The problem with that is the boy had frostbite on his hands. So he was actually in the woods, and he didn't say the man, he said the bear. So this story, I wish I could have talked to him after this, really asked him some questions. There are stories of some Sasquatches kind of having a snout like the dog man and stuff. He would look very bear-like to a three-year-old. I have a three-year-old granddaughter. She would probably call Bigfoot a big bear. So I thought this was a great story to talk about. This story, it's positive. This area, the people in North Carolina, the two researchers I talked to, they told me, we're surprised he came out because it's so rugged and so rough and not a good place to get lost. So maybe that's the other reason the FBI, they understand the urgency of getting in there and finding him quick because the area wasn't conducive to him making it. But he did. And the other thing that was interesting is they found him by a road, pretty close to a road, like he was placed there. So it's a very compelling story. It even made Newsweek. All right, I think we're going to have to click on these, maybe. Yep, please. Okay, stop. Don't click on the next one yet. That first recording, the first one is the Sasquatch. The second one is the response. Can you tell the difference?
Can you play it again? Technical
difficulties. Oh yeah, my mic is working out.
Oh,
there. So the first one is the Sasquatch. The second one is a gentleman that used to be one of our co-founders. It's no longer with our group, but his name was Scott Walters from Lincoln, Nebraska. So he was one of our co-founders, and that's him responding. I was down at my truck. I want to explain it. And so I was down at my truck, and it was really, really cold out. It was in May. And usually we can't get into this place in May, but that year we didn't have very much snow, so I could get in there. I was about maybe 100 yards from that, because this recording was done probably from a quarter mile away up on a knoll. So this was right in front of me in the tree line, and it was talking to me. It was whooping at me, because I was standing out in a little open, and I had my hood up because it was really cold out, and I looked big like a Sasquatch. So it was whooping at me from the tree line, and then Scott responded from the knoll behind us, and he got this recording. So do the second one. No, that's okay. So that's my son. He was about 12 at the time, and he was with Scott, and he was acknowledging that they heard it. Okay, so go to the last one. So that's you know, sometimes we get that and we don't know why. So I wanted you to hear that. Okay. It's the curse of the Sasquatch. Technical difficulties. There we go. There, a lot of people have conjecture about tree structures. This is a tree structure to me, and the reason there's two right next to each other. And I know this group. I've known this group for a long, long time. And they're trying to tell me there's three of them and where they're headed. Okay? I know that sounds weird, and it is weird, but that's what it is. There used to be five. Two of them are gone. I don't know why. But they leave me signs that I'm off in this direction, so I know where to make my calls. And sure enough, if I make my calls that way, a lot of times I'll get responses because they've had to move. The BLM's coming in there and kind of messed up the dynamic a little bit. And so they've moved and they wanted me to know where to find them. They used to whoop when I drive my truck in. They used to run on either side of my truck in the woods and whoop when I drive in. They don't do that anymore, but they used to. But they're still there, and there's three of them, and I did
have an encounter with them last year. So there's three left. What's also interesting is, and you guys will like this a lot, I got a report from a Hispanic man and on my website, and he said, we had an encounter at one of the area lakes not too far from my area. And he said it was his first time camping in his new camper with his wife. And I asked him some questions. But he was fishing at this lake in the middle of the night, and they saw this big dark shadow go by his truck. And there was light moonlight, so he could see it go by really, really quickly. And then he could hear him back in the background talking. And I'm confident it was my group of three because of what they did and some of the things he told me. But I asked him a question which I thought was really poignant. I said, are you or your wife Native American by chance? He goes, my wife. Why do you ask? I said, I don't know. I said, they just seem to sometimes find Native American folks and then they try to talk to them. And that's what happened in this encounter. They came back to the camper and his wife was in there. She's Lakota Sioux. And they tried to talk to her for quite a while that night, they said. And he was shocked that I asked that question because he didn't say anything about his wife. She wasn't in the report. Nothing. I just asked him. I said, either one of you happen to be Native American by chance? And he said, yes, my wife. And he was like, wow. How'd you know that? I said, well, it's kind of a hunch. No. I'm from Parker. That's the structure right next to the down tree fall. That's a little teepee. They're just letting me. So how do I read this? I read this that we've moved our home, the three of us, up on this hill over here. And that seems to be where they come from now. So structures go together. Miracles do happen. Oh, I'm missing one. Again. There we go. So people ask me about this picture because it's on our website a lot. And people are always focused on the negative about Bigfoot too much. But there's a lot of positive things. A lot of positive things happen in the forest. Especially for me. It's changed my life. I'm not going to lie. And I've been in the forest since I was 14 years old in Colorado. I've only seen one tree like this. You know how I found this tree? I found this tree. I heard chant. Actually, I didn't hear chanting. My son had brought a friend with him. His name was Kevin from Florida. And it was his first trip into the woods. And Kevin wakes me up in the morning and goes, Mr. Johnson, Mr. Johnson, Mr. Johnson, Mr. Johnson. He goes, there's chanting in the forest. I'm like, what? He goes, there's chanting in the forest. You know what day it was? It was June 21st, the solstice. He goes, there's chanting in the forest. And I get up, and my son and I, because it was just my son, Trenton, I, and Kevin. And we got up really quick. I said, get your clothes on. We went over and heard the chanting. And where we heard the chanting coming from, we found this tree. Now, I've seen a million trees. I've hiked all over the forest. I challenge any one of you to find a tree like this. You can do it for the rest of your life and you won't find a tree like this. It's just a weird thing that's happened to me that I don't understand, but it happened. This is one of the places I go. It's a big place. Isn't it beautiful? So what's unique about this place? It's got one of the largest herds of elk in the world. It also has a massive sheep population of about 50,000 that gets poured into this area. They also put cows in there, and there's only one road through there, and it's closed 6 months of the year. So it's perfect for Sasquatches. It's a great place to go. I wanted you to see where I'm going so you'd kind of get a feel for the places that I go. So I like this. I got this from California, from the Redwood Forest. So if you look online, you'll see all kinds of renditions of Sasquatch. This is a really neat one. And it's got a face like a human. Doesn't have a face like a Bigfoot. It's got a hairy body like a Bigfoot. So this is somebody's version of a Sasquatch. We happen to have a Sasquatch on our website that Jeff Yellick got a picture of it, looks like this. We also have one on our website that doesn't look like this at all. I can't account for why there's two different faces on our website, but it appears to me there's more than one type of Sasquatch. That's the only logical conclusion you can draw. But here in California, they're saying this one. And Patty, I don't know that Patty necessarily has the face of a human. I don't know. I look at it, and I don't know. But a lot of people put a human face on Sasquatch, and we have that face on our website. So last year, we had an opportunity to do an expedition with Dr. Melvin. And it was fun. It was limited in scope because they were filming, so only a couple of people could go on this. And Tony had worked with Dr. Melvin in the past, so I let Tony go because he'd done Oma Wing, which is a documentary that we have that I hope you'll ask to see. If you email Tony, T-O-N-Y, at omawing.com, he'll let you watch his infrasound documentary. It's award-winning. It's won about four awards at shows. It's called Tony at Oma Wing, and you email him, he'll let you watch it. So, but he's worked with Dr. Melvin in the past, so he got to go on that. And it was fun. I got to see the scientific side of things, which I think is important, because I want to be as scientific as I possibly can be. I do. So it was very good. It was very good. So here's the hair sample that we got. That's in the baggie. That's a pretty big hair sample. There's half of it out of the baggie. So what's unique about this? My son and I have seen this Sasquatch. He's got hair like a big orangutan. That looks like big orangutan hair, doesn't it? It's pretty orange. I don't know that many things in Colorado that's got that color of hair. That's not really cinnamon bear hair color. The hair is too fine. So I don't know what it is, but it came from right at one of our sites. And it's right where he stands all the time. The big Sasquatch, he's giant. And what's funny is my relatives, I went back for my grandmother's funeral I told you about. And one of the girls I went to high school with owns the Rolling Hills Zoo off of I-70. And she has an orangutan, so I took my son over there, and he was laying on the ground with his head covered up in his arms, and my son goes, "Dad, that's the hair. It looks just like the hair." I said, "Can't argue that. We've both seen him." Uh-oh. There we go. Okay, this is a new location I have. It's called Hell's Canyon. And it's up in northern Colorado. It's in the foothills above one of the big cities. And a BFRO member out of Ohio's relatives own it. I did a documentary with them. It's called Chasing Bigfoot. It used to be on Amazon Prime. And he owned 40 acres. And I think that's why he sought me out to do it, because he wanted me to look at his 40 acres because he thinks there's Bigfoot's on it. So I was like, oh, okay. So I went out there, you know, thinking, what are the chances? So we're driving up. It's private land. There's only three houses on the private land. The homeowner, one of the three homeowners that owns the cabins on this, is in front of us at the gate. It's locked. You cannot get in here. He's got Sasquatch stickers all over the back of his truck. So I run out and get out and knock on the side of his truck and start talking. He goes, "Oh, yeah, I'm here." I was like, well, that was easy. You know, one of the other homeowners is telling me they're here. So then I start poking around like I do. So this place, coming out of that, is a spring. I love springs. Because in Colorado, if you drink out of the river, you're going to get the beaver fever. Giardia, they call it the beaver fever, and it's tough to get rid of. And you get sick as a dog. You get the runs and all the nasty things you don't want to have. I was on an expedition one time with the BFRO, and a gentleman from Louisiana didn't know that. Drank the water right out of the beaver pond. I was like, oh, no. I never saw him come back again. So, but there's a spring here, and it flows right out of that rock. And that has significance, because I think the Sasquatch drinks out of this spring. There's his footprint. I knew I was onto something. This is right next to the spring. There's an elk print. So the elk are drinking out of it. There's a Sasquatch footprint. And that's in a sand pile. So you can't really cast it too well, but you can see, one thing I really like when I see is a big heel. A big heel and a big flat print. And there was about four of them in a row. But that one I like the best. I mean, that's really a pretty good print in the dirt in Colorado. I usually don't get stuff like that. I'm not very good at this. So one thing that was really interesting in that Hell's Canyon, sitting up on a little ledge, was this skull. This deer skull, and it was like it was placed there. And if you look at this deer skull, the cranium, the top pulled off of it. So something ate it and placed it there. And it was like 5 feet off the ground. So, you know, I hate to say this, this is terrible, but people eat monkey brain. So, you know, a lot of people eat brain. Maybe Sasquatch eats brain, too. There's one elk pile by the spring. There's number two. There's number three. What's interesting is all the elk, there's about a herd of about 500 down on private land at the bottom of the canyon. I didn't see one elk when I was on the 40 acres. So he's killing the elk somewhere in between and bringing them back to his watering hole, sitting there drinking his nice water in his private little canyon and eating where nobody ever goes. Because this guy, Ron's now in his 60s, and this is a hard place to get into. He doesn't go in there anymore. So I'm going with his relative Anna, and they let me go in here now. So we have access to this private land, and it's pretty good. I'm pretty confident these are Sasquatch. I mean, the only other thing it could be is a mountain lion, but I didn't find any mountain lion tracks. I found Sasquatch. So, how am I doing on time? Can somebody help me? Okay, perfect. So how many people know what this video slide is of? It's very controversial. This is Mama Baby that was taken in Vermont. Okay? And a lot of people say it's First Nation. Nobody in Vermont knew what it was. First Nations out of Canada said, that's a Sasquatch. I agree. That's a Sasquatch. There's some telltale things that tell me that's a Sasquatch. Giant head, no neck. Giant back. And the other reason I posted this slide is look at the white spot. Look at the white splotches on it. Sasquatches have monstrous chests. They have monstrous chests. And this, so what you're seeing is she's sensing the camera, and she's ducking down. And this isn't a very good slide, but she's got a baby under her arm, and that's a massive arm. That's a massive arm. Their arms are immense. There's a coyote. Boy, those didn't come out very good. There's a coyote. So what's happening here is this Vermont homeowner put this trail cam up because he has an apple tree on his property. The apples were getting eaten off the top of the tree in circles, and he couldn't figure it out, so he put a trail cam out. He got that picture. He got the coyote following the Sasquatch. Oh, this one's better. So here is a slide for comparison. Everybody in Nebraska knows Mr. Coyote. So here's the same branch for scale. I love scale. There's the branch. There's the branch. That's a pretty big thing. It's a pretty compelling slide to me. Somebody tried to tell me, there's a guy that gets on the web every time that I talk about this, because that's an owl. It's just close to the camera. I'm like, no. I had two great horned owls that lived on my property in Kansas when I was a boy, right by my window in a tree. That's not an owl. Yeah, here, this is its head, that's its back, and its arm goes down like this. So I encourage you to go on the web and look at it. So he's hunching down, and that's what they do. They try, when they come by, you'll walk right by them because they'll hunch down like a rock and hope you walk by in the darkness. It's a great technique to hide from people. People just think they're walking by a boulder or something because we don't see that great in the dark. Yeah, just a stump or something. So that is that's the other thing that tells me this is legit. That is a legitimate thing that Sasquatches really do to hide. They duck. It's happened to me. I'm going to talk about that. That I don't know. And that's the other reason that I think it's a Sasquatch. And I'm going to show you why. This is a picture from Ron Peterson from one of our areas, pretty close to Denver. A lot of people, and I don't know, but a lot of people tell me that's a face lit up on the top. So if you follow this tree up, there's a face lit up right there. I don't know, but it looks like a face to me. So there's a phenomenon, an omaline. Tony talks about infrasound. The gentleman, his name is Ron Peterson, that took this photo, got blasted with whatever this Sasquatches can do. And he ran to his vehicle and he was dysfunctional. Couldn't even use his vehicle, couldn't leave, couldn't do anything. But when he got this picture, it affected him so immensely from whatever was happening here that he couldn't function. So, I don't know. A lot of people think that that's the big male and that's what he's doing right there. So, I don't know. I'm just pointing it out. I'm just showing the evidence as it comes. So, this is our picture. You got mama baby. She's doing something similar. So, there's the white splotches on her that nobody can explain. It's not the camera. It didn't do it on the coyote. Here's a picture from another lady from the collegiate range in Colorado. Looks to me like the face is lit up again. She said she felt sick after taking this picture. Well, I don't know. I'm just pointing out the evidence that we get. And sometimes there's coincidences in the evidence, and it comes from all places. This photo is from central Colorado in the collegiate range. The other one is from near Pikes Peak. The other one is from Vermont. There's all these strange white something in there that I can't explain, but you have to note it. And I'm going to be honest with you. I've had a similar type of experience where I got to see something that really kind of shook me up and I didn't understand what I was seeing. I wondered if I was seeing a ghost. So, what's ironic is this place was closed down by the Forest Service and after 10 o'clock. So you used to be able to camp there all night and it's by a mine. You used to be able to camp there all night and it was closed down by the Forest Service. And the hunter that sent me this picture, he asked one of the rangers, he said, too many people are reporting ghosts there. What a strange reason to close. But that's what he told them. He goes, I'm going to be honest with you, that's why we're closing it. So this is the main reason, one of the main reasons I like to go to Sasquatch, and I get to go to the most beautiful places in the world and hang out for a week with some of my favorite people in the world. And thank you for your attention.
We will have 5 minutes of questions for Mike Johnson. Mike, you said you were going to explain the white splotches.
Oh, I wish I could. I don't know why if they're doing it or how they're doing it.